Good evening, friends. This side, Rahul Magan here is a Group Chief Executive Officer, Treasury Consulting, and also a venture capitalist. Standing today on 4th September 2019, practically 1 a.m. in the morning, we're going to have another very important video about the venture capitalist. As you very well understand that, Treasury Consulting is a Singaporean multinational group. We are also a venture capitalist, but unfortunately, we are not Sequoia and we are not SoftBank who have a habit of investing in a company who are always loss-making companies or those who are playing valuation game. Okay, so when we were when we were very young in the college, you know, maybe in the school, we being informed about a line that somebody's gain is somebody's loss and somebody's loss in somebody's gain. Now this is part one of this video, right? Part 2 of this video is that which is alternate investments. We know that in alternate investments, venture capitalists and private equity are shaping up at a very faster pace and should be. There is nothing wrong in that. Now, the third part of the game, which is the Indian startup story, whereby more than 30-40% of the startup die in the first 2 years of existence. Maybe they don't have a vision. Maybe they don't have the financing, and the government support is always zero. And last but not the least, they do not know where are they heading. Now we need to mix all these things one by one. And fourth important thing which is coming in the picture is the NIRP, which is negative interest rate policy. As we already stated long ago that the negative interest rate policy is happening worldwide. There are many currencies like Japanese yen, like Swiss franc, like DKK, Danish Krona, NOK, Norwegian Krona, and multiple those who are in the negative territory. In fact, that is a different thing that the best foreign exchange traders of the globe are still able to get the carry out of it. But the question is that the total investable corpus of the globe is approximately $39 trillion. This is being suggested by Bloomberg. And one of the reports of the Bloomberg does suggest that the $13 trillion worth out of 39, which is practically one third, is under negative interest rate policy. Multiple reports from different sources does suggest that this $13 trillion is now moved to $19 trillion, right? And there is a report in the public domain from various, from an institute who governs the sovereign wealth, basically covers sovereign wealth funds. They suggest that the sovereign, now the Norwegian sovereign fund, Nordic sovereign wealth fund, basically Norwegian sovereign wealth fund, now they have invested approximately 60 billion euro in the negative interest rate policy. And this is not the only instance where sovereign wealth fund are investing their money in the negative interest rate policy. In fact, there are news that they have started investing in more negative interest rate related currencies also. But I will take an indemnification right away that there is no official link I have which I can say. This is all from my professional sources. You know that being an ex-corporate treasurer, your professional sources are very, very high. Now the time has come when we need to link the four. First, SoftBank burned not less than $2 billion in India. But they are very lucky that Indian regulator and unfortunately now Singaporean regulator is not interested to create a valuation standard for venture capitalists. Henceforth, companies like Sequoia and SoftBank, they are having free hand playing valuation. Now, what is the standard line they have, which is the post-money valuation equal to pre-money valuation plus amount invested? I am ready to challenge SoftBank and Sequoia in case they can prove this all true. A loss-making company or any company in the globe cannot have the valuation on this principle that the post-money valuation equal to pre-money valuation plus the amount invested. Everybody, I think most of the people, those who are watching this video, would have heard about the name Lenskart, a company who is selling the lenses. And in New Delhi and in Singapore, in various places of India, you have the shops of the Lenskart. You would be surprised to know that Lenskart is having a shop in one of the metro stations we have in Delhi, which is known as Rajiv Chowk. It's Rajiv Chowk, and all those people, those from Delhi, they know that Rajiv Chowk is one of the centrally located metro stations we have in Delhi. and this is in Connaught Place. And at a inner of the Rajiv Chowk, Lenskart is having a metro having a shop. Now you can very well imagine that what would be the rent metro people would be charging from the Lenskart. You would be thinking where I am heading, but we need to link all this in a very dedicated way. Lenskart is in losses since inception. But the hard reality is that now Lenskart is being sold over $1 billion company. I don't know how many people reading one business newspaper in a day, but I definitely read business newspaper in a day and always in the night shooting a video. In fact, all the important articles I do cut and put it in my file for the future reference. God knows when I need them. Yesterday, last week, two important things happened in the venture capital space. Number one, Meru. Meru is a cab riding company, and people, those who are in India, they know that Meru operates in the multiple cities of India, including New Delhi. Meru sold 50% something stake in their company to somebody. I think they sold to Mahindra, and the valuation they paid is roughly 100 crores. So 55% of the stake of the Meru being sold at 100 crores. So to practically Meru is a 200 crore company. A company who do have an asset in the book, a company who do have the vehicles in the book, is being valued 200 crores. That is a different thing. That company is relatively not high profit, but it is in profit. It is in profit. While the Lenskart, which is in losses since inception, having their stores in one of the costliest places in India and always in losses, is being valued at $1 billion. Except God, no one in this globe can convince at least me that which valuation standard we are using to get it valued. That a loss-making company who never saw profitability, who do not have any asset in the book, is being valued over $1 billion. Only because some venture capitalists are doing valuation game, and they're relying on an obsolete equation, which is the post-money valuation equal to pre-money valuation plus amount invested. While a cab riding company, which is Ola, which is Meru, is being sold 200 crores. So 55% of the stake is being sold over 100 crores. This is where we are heading with the one established company compared to one, although established but in losses. See the difference in the valuation. One 200 crores and one approximately $1 billion, which is closer to, if I go with the today's rate, USD to INR, which is roughly 72, it's being closer to 7,200 crores. Now, if we summarize all this, due to the negative interest rate policy, the sovereign wealth fund, they left with no option but to invest in the startups, because they know one thing, they are flush with the AUM, asset under management, and they have to invest this money of the investor. Now, the biggest mistake which they are doing is that they are coming to those startups who even do not know that where are they heading, what is the business model, or those who are doing the hit and trial. So let me read this for you, which is there in the today's newspaper. Now this suggests that, look at the heading, this suggests that startups look beyond SoftBank to pension fund for the big checks. So this is like that. Bulge bracket venture capital funds such as SoftBank used to lord over the funding landscape for large scale startup in India. Now pension fund and the sovereign wealth fund are moving in and loaded with the money risk appetite and willingness to wait for longer. Pension fund, Canada Pension Fund, Canada Pension Plan Investment Board, while Sovereign Wealth Fund, which is Qatar Investment Authority, joined education firm Baiju $300 million funding across two rounds in December 2018 and another $300 million on investment. I fail to understand that why Baiju needs so much huge amount of money. Only because valuation, because you hired Shah Rukh Khan, and you need a huge amount of money. Why after every 3-4 months you need more than $300 million of money? $300 million is a very big amount. In Indian rupee term, it is more than 2,100 crores. And after every few months, you need $300 million. But if you ask the question from these startups who are being promoted by Shah Rukh Khan, like in case of DHFL, which is Diwan Housing Financing, now it is ICICI Bank, and there are multiple endorsements like Virat Kohli endorsed Punjab National Bank. If you are asking this question from them, then of course you are either somebody go to the right side of the YouTube and bring the negative thumbs down, it doesn't matter, or they will start giving you the anti-national certificate. The job do not end here. It does suggest that online pharmacy, Farm Easy, So multiple online pharmacies are giving 20-30% discounts over the MRP. So the maximum retail price, which is MRP, they are giving 20-30% discount. And one of the online pharmacy, Mahendra Singh Dhoni, is also a brand endorser. But still, these online pharmacy believe that they are profit. One day the sun will rise when they would be profitable. So online pharmacy Farm Easy is currently raising 130 million from Singapore government Tavas. I have already raised my concern about the Singapore investment policy now. Singapore government owned Tavask and GIC. I think GIC invested in the road construction project 2,400 crores. And Tavask Capital has also started lending money to those startups who are in a deep red or in the losses. The trust is being losing, at least from my side, to the Singapore because it's taxpayer money, and taxpayer money should not be invested on a startup. So if you are opening a medical, if you are opening a pharmacy, you are offering 20-30% discount. You are hiring Mahendra Singh Dhoni as a brand endorser. How long do you need to be profitable? You need several years to be profitable. And if you continue to fund these companies, then we know Flipkart is an example, Snapdeal is an example, Quikr is an example, Mahindra is an example, Jabong is an example, and the list is pretty long. And now we have another example, which is Lenskart. But is the media is really interested talking about that? Is the media really interested talking, criticizing that the Lenskart, which used to be whatever the next Apple of India, you know, now why is being sold? Why do it happen that the founders raise the money, make themselves rich, and after 3-4 years they sell the company? I term this as the shortened life cycle of entrepreneurship. Because entrepreneurship life cycle is very long. Steve Jobs raised initial money from Mike Makula. But after that he moved on. And rest is history. When he left, Apple was the most valued company of the globe. And even today Apple is amongst the most valued company of the globe. They are not relying on external debt. But Indian startups and multiple startups worldwide, they are too much hungry for the money. And after every 2 months they raise the money. And they feel that this is the only way to sustain. By the way, the story do not end here. The story does suggest that pension fund and the sovereign wealth fund increasing tech investment is a global trend because they wanted to expose them to good opportunities which will never come. They also wanted to generate benchmark beating return alpha. I am giving you in writing that benchmark alpha will never come. Because after this we're going to have another video and then we'll discuss more about that. And is aided by the good exit multiple from the tech companies. But anyways, to cut the long discussion short, now it's a good time for venture cap from startups, because you have any idea, people are ready with the money, but Treasury Consulting will never go and raise the money from the venture capitalists. You have a single idea, you go to them, you raise the money, make yourself rich, and after a few years you just close the company or wind it up, let several hundred people be on the road. Media will not cover you because media is paid and sold. This is how the venture capitalist is running now. A noble profession which was created to help people, which was created to help the companies, those who originally have ideas but do not have the money, is now a valuation profession. Whereby few people like SoftBank, Sequoia and few another only for the sake of exit multiples, and they have made their loss, and regulators cannot run away from that, to be honest. Because regulators need to understand that if they don't make the loss, if they don't make things stringent, then the 2008 was known for the financial crisis. And today India startup story is dying because you can fund the company but you cannot create a business model. That you need to understand. If SoftBank is not short of money, Sequoia is not short of money, we need to understand that. But can SoftBank and Sequoia create Apple? Why Micromax, which was once termed as an Apple of India, now Micromax private equity player has quit. The valuation of the Micromax is 93% down, and God knows the valuation is going to get down more. One of the senior professionals of the Micromax said in the public domain that it's very difficult to compete with the foreign players considering their pricing power. So, venture capitalists and private equity, they can only invest the money, but they cannot create Apple, they cannot create Microsoft, Salesforce. sales force. I think it's more than several years the VCs and PEs are pumping their money on the sales force. And there is a news that they have now decided to buy the Tableau as well. God knows whether it's being materialized or not. But is the sales force is in profit? Lyft, Uber. Lyft in Uber, they already IPO, initial public offer, but you go open Google and check where are they. Venture capitalist and private equity can create these bogus investment models, but they cannot make them profitable. Had it been, they would have created several Apples, Microsoft, Facebook and Googles, but they cannot. And I assure you one thing, that in 2019, you have lots of example like Uber, you have Lyft, you have a lot of Lenskart, Flipkart and all these. Every passing year, the examples will grow. And the day is not far, probably 5 years or 10 years down the line, the day is not far when the VC would be most disrespectful profession we have of the globe, because of the few people, the last line, who played valuation game. But at the end, treasury consulting VC desk is not like that. We know principles, we go by the principle. It doesn't matter what feedback people carried about us. But at the end of the day, we know one thing, that life brings back to circle. 2008 financial crisis happened because of the lot of negative things the banks did. And in fact, today also, they are doing. Maybe 5 years down the line, like had I said 4 years before, that India would be a bankrupt economy. And when I said that, not many people trusted me. But today, I am telling you, India would be the bankrupt economy by 2024. And maybe 4 or 5 years down the line, the venture capitalist, which is a very noble profession, would be the most disrespectful profession we have. People will disrespect a venture capitalist because of such kind of stuff, that it's a valuation game which you are doing. With this, treasury consulting, thank you very much. And you know my mobile number, +91 9899242978. You know our fixed income platform, rahul.magan@treasuryconsulting.in. We thank you very much and have a great time.